The beer with a taste as smooth as its name.
ESPN presents Major League Baseball Magazine. This is Warner Fusselle with 1987, our year in review. The 1987 season got off to a rollicking start in Milwaukee, where the Brewers mystified the experts with one win after another. This is a young team, they said, 2 or 3 years away. Maybe so. But the Brewers just kept on winning. Then, on a rainy night in Baltimore, 22-year-old Juan Nieves parlayed some spectacular outfield play into a moment most pitchers can only dream of.
Brewers lead 7-0. Yount
makes a great catch, and Juan Nieves has thrown the first no-hitter in Milwaukee Brewer history. What else can happen to this team?
What else? Well, how about tying the Major League record for the best start ever?
The swing and a miss, and the Milwaukee Brewers have won 13 games without a loss.
A different sort of streak befell Cincinnati's Eric Davis during an April series with Houston. Mike Scott struck out the multi-talented Davis 4 straight times, and the next day, Nolan Ryan did the same. When all was said and done, Eric had struck out 9 consecutive times. Payback would be in order. Atlanta's Deion James was also hitting on a wing and a prayer in April. He got the wing, and the bird never had a prayer.
Side to left. And this ball is going to... It hit a bird!
You believe that?
I've never seen that!
Of course, that's what April's all about. Ball hits foul, you end up on second, and get a few first out of the way.
He doesn't like it.
That's the first ew of the 1987 season.
Philadelphia's Mike Schmidt also played the numbers in April, receiving his third MVP award, and on April 18th, hitting his 500th home run.
3-0 pitch.
Swing and low drive! There it is!
If nothing else, it was certainly one of the more animated steps in Mike Schmidt's journey to the Hall of Fame. Bob Horner was big news in May, at least in Japan, where his debut with the Yakult Swallows was a smashing success. Horner obviously had a yen for Japanese pitching. But the very next day, he hit 3 more. Montreal's Tim Raines made a belated May debut in 1987 due to his status as a free agent. But Raines made it quite clear he was back in his very first at-bat with a triple against the Mets. 2 more hits followed. Then, the big one.
Drive into deep left field. McReynolds watching. Would you believe a grand slam for Tim Raines? That has to be one of the most incredible stories of the year in any sport. The first day back.
An incredible season was already brewing in Chicago, where Andre Dawson was smashing 14 home runs through May on his way to an MVP year. Cardinals' Jack Clark was another powerful presence in May. With 32 RBIs in just 1 month, Clark left more than a few National League pitchers speechless. Almost. And what about our old friend, Eric Davis? Well, he started making contact and hit three grand slams in the month of May alone.
Carmen from the belt, 2-1 pitch, and here is a drive into deep right field. Wilson is way back. It is a slam.
Oh, boy. He just hammered a ball. Home run.
Davis gives it a ride again.
Oh.
Are you kidding me? That's his third home run of the day.
As they say, paybacks can be hell. In Chicago, longtime Cubs announcer Harry Carey was sidelined with a stroke. So Cubs fan and veteran Ghostbuster Bill Murray came on to pinch it for a day, and did so most solemnly.
Starting for the Expos in left field, Casey Kendall. He's no good. In right field is Mitch Webster. He's no good. But first is Andre. Told you folks at home to say that name. Andre Galarraga. I don't think there's any question, but the names on the Cubs are a lot easier to pronounce, and they seem to be more like baseball players' names.
Let her
go.
Oh,
well,
it's a left field.
Get out.
Way
get out.
Back.
Yeah.
You can forget it. It's gone. Home run, Jody Davis, his second home run of the year. How about that one?
Chaka Honobro.
Everybody on their feet here in Wrigley Field.
Come on, let's hear it for him.
Now, we grant you, no one ever accused Harry Carey of being impartial when it came to the Cubs. And in that respect, as his substitute for the day, Bill Murray certainly earned his stripes. June brought a touch of brotherly love to the park as Joe and Phil Niekro set a big league record for victories by brothers with 530. The Niekros have always been close, and folks figured it was just a matter of time before they passed the Perrys. Because of everything the Niekros have done together in their lives, the best thing they've done is pitch. Pitching also came easy to Philadelphia's Steve Bedrosian in June, as he set a major league record with 13 straight saves on his way to the Cy Young Award. Which brings us back to our old friend Eric Davis, who in early June took Jack Clark to the cleaners.
Going in a swing and a long one in the left center field, and is going to be. He caught it for the second out. Unbelievable.
The very next day, it was deja vu.
Clark drills one to deep left center field, and it is. Well, did he do it again? He must have a baseball in his glove.
Well, sometimes it looked that way in 87, as outfielders everywhere soared to new heights. July brought the 58th All-Star Game to Oakland Alameda Coliseum, led by honorary captains Billy Williams, and Catfish Hunter. But it was Steve Bedrosian who saved the National League, more so with his glove than his arm. Ninth inning, still scoreless, and a double play grounder that goes awry. But when Dave Winfield tries to score, Bedrock and Ozzie Virgil shut the door. Then in the 13th, Tim Raines tripled the National League to its 14th win in the last 16 games and earned himself the MVP. Perennial All-Star Don Mattingly certainly looked like an MVP in July when he tied a Major League record with home runs in 8 consecutive games. Mattingly hit 10 home runs during the 8-game stretch, and 2 of them were grand slams.
Here it goes. Long drive and a grand slam. Upper deck for Mattingly. His 6th of the year.
Meanwhile, down in the Pioneer League, the Salt Lake City Trappers simply couldn't lose. And with each passing day, the eyes of the nation focused more and more on this ragamuffin band of renegades en route to pro baseball history. You know, it was bad enough that baseballs were leaving stadiums at a record pace in 87. It didn't help matters any if you had a Teflon glove. Or, in extreme cases, if you had no glove at all. Exhibition Stadium, Toronto, the dog days of summer. And Lloyd Mosby tries to steal first.
There goes Mosby. Takes a good pitch to go on. Terrible throw. Mosby doesn't know where the throw is. He's going back to first base. Is he going to steal first? He steals
Look
first.
At him.
Now he's going to steal second again. I've never seen it before.
Stealing any base came easy to Bobby Bonds back in the 70s. Bonds was a prototype 30-30 player, 30 steals, 30 home runs. But in 1987, an unprecedented 4 players gained entry into the 30-30 club, led once again by Eric Davis.
Long way to left field. This ball game is over, folks.
The rare combination of speed and power also manifested itself in Cleveland's Joe Carter. The New York Mets, Darryl Strawberry. And the surprising Howard Johnson, who enabled one team to feature 2 30-30 players in the same year for the first time in baseball history. Still another record fell by the wayside in August as Oakland's Mark McGwire set a new standard for rookies.
And that one may be it, way back. And there's your record, Mark McGwire with his Major League rookie record, 39th home run.
Well, whether you're swinging from the heels or just laying down breathless bunts, the name of the game in baseball is consistency. And in that respect, 2 August performances are noteworthy. Kevin Seitzer of Kansas City came to bat 6 times on August 2nd and came away with 6 hits, including 2 homers and 7 RBIs.
And he goes to right deep. Greenwell back, and he can't get it. It bounces away from him into the stands. A ground rule double and 2 runs score, and he is 6 for 6. 7 runs batted in. What a day for the third baseman for the Royals.
Then, at the end of the month, Minnesota's Kirby Puckett duplicated that feat. He went 6-for-6 with 2 doubles and 2 homers. And he didn't have that bad a day in the field either.
Well hit. Way back. Oh, touch them all, Kirby Puckett. What a game. His second home run, 6-for-6, and he has 10 hits in his last 11 bats. How phenomenal.
Even more phenomenal in terms of consistency was the hitting streak put together by Milwaukee's Paul Molitor. The Molitor watch became a daily ritual all over the country, and he didn't disappoint.
That's hit high and deep to left field. Back goes Mike Young to the wall. It's gone. Paul Molitor, in what is probably his final at bat, clubs a home run to extend his hitting streak to 28 consecutive games.
Paul went on to hit in 39 straight games, fifth longest streak in baseball history. Under pressure, a touch of class. Paul Molitor. Of course, not everyone relied on natural talent in 87. Take Joe Niekro, for instance. An emery board in my pocket? I don't know how that got there. Someone must have put it there. Or Philadelphia's Kevin Gross. Sandpaper in my glove? Why, I have no idea, Mr. Umpire. And then there was Billy Hatcher's bat. You know, the one with the cork in it. Cork? In my bat? You got me. September was a month for milestones, as Vince Coleman again stole his 100th base. The man Whitey simply lets run has now reached the century mark in steals in each of his first 3 seasons. In Houston, the indomitable Nolan Ryan racked up his 210th strikeout of the year, setting a major league record for strikeouts by a pitcher 40 years or older. Ryan has sawed off more than a few bats in his day, and he wouldn't have appreciated what the Angels' Jack Howell did on September 5th.
Breaks his bat and hits a drive to right field. It's a broken bat home run.
How do you like that? It?
Check the bat, right? Check the bat is right. The broken part went beyond first base. They want to check it, too. That's the first broken bat home run I've ever seen. That ought to go in a trophy case, pal.
Consistency. It emerged from a most unlikely source as the season moved into October. With a 34-game hitting streak, San Diego rookie Benito Santiago earned himself a unanimous decision as the National League Rookie of the Year. In Boston, American League batting champion Wade Boggs banged out 200 hits for the fifth straight year. San Diego's Tony Gwynn won the National League batting title with a .370 average, highest since Stan Musial in 1948. Toronto's George Bell had an amazing MVP season with 47 homers and 134 RBIs. And on the last day of the season, Boston's Roger Clemens earned the Cy Young Award with his 20th win. It was clinch time in St. Louis, where the Cardinals played host to the Expos, while the Mets watched from the press box. And St. Louis left no margin for error.
Little check to Cox. Throws on. They win it!
The Cardinals' opponent had already been determined, thanks to a humbaby of a game against San Diego.
The 1-1 pitch.
Swung on, fly ball to left field. Back goes Leonard. He's at the track. He makes the catch, and the Giants have won the Western Division. And on the field go the Giants.
It went down to the final day in Detroit, where the Tigers emerged from the American League East shadows to ambush Jimmy Williams and the Toronto Blue Jays.
Tapper could be the ball game. Tanana, Evans, Tigers, champions.
And it was a lonely band of Minnesota faithful down in Texas the day the Twins saw their miracle begin.
And a little fly ball to the second baseman, Robert Rosier, throw to first, they got it! The Twins win the championship! Twins win 5-3!
In the American League Championship Series, Minnesota disposed of Detroit in just 5 games. The Giants took St. Louis to the limit in the National League, but the result was much the same. It will be the Cardinals and the Twins in the 1987 World Series, opening in the cacophonic confines of the Metrodome. Minnesota's low-key manager, Tom Kelly, watched with no apparent delight as Dan Gladden grand slammed the Twins to a 10-1 victory in the opener. The Twins were finding heroes everywhere, like light-hitting Randy Bush, whose bases-loaded double paved the way for an 8-4 Minnesota win in Game 2 and a 2-0 series lead. It was more of a bird's-eye view back in St. Louis, as Vince Coleman snapped a hitting slump with a 2-run double. The hit gave the Cardinals a 3-1 victory and put a little fight back in their fans. There was no need to monitor the Cardinals. They were far from dead. And in Game 4, they even got a little cocky. St. Louis stole 5 bases to win Game 5 and now returned to the Metrodome with a 3-2 series lead. But for the Twins, there was no place like Dome, as Kent Herbeck's grand slam evened the count at 3. And when, in the 87 series, all was said and done, it was the Minnesota Twins for whom the dream had just begun.
Myself in the same old way, taking another picture.